In the primer video, I've mentioned that Bitcoin uses a peer-to-peer network. And peer-to-peer networks are quite different to what you will usually see in payment or transactional systems. Now, to really understand why they are different, why they are potentially more robust, and how everything works behind the scenes, you have to look at various examples, how they are built, and how information is exchanged. All right, today we're going to talk about one key component of blockchain technology, and that's peer-to-peer networks. The idea there is that you have a network where everyone is equal, where you have no special privileges. And as you will see, blockchain isn't the first technology to employ that. I mean, there have been many examples of peer-to-peer network throughout history. Two of the most prominent ones are, of course, Napster and LimeWire, peer-to-peer file sharing networks with the idea that you have audio files, music, you have videos, pretty much any media that could be shared over these networks. And since these networks, or this file sharing approach, mostly didn't care so much for copyright law, and was illegal in most cases, of course, these networks had to be structured in a certain way. If you just had a centralized server, let's say, where you could download a new music album or the newest movie, Hollywood blockbuster that was in theaters at that time, probably wouldn't work because the regulators would step in. And that's why these people had to look for alternative approaches for networks that couldn't be stopped that easily, for networks that were peer-to-peer. Yeah, Napster is one example, as I mentioned, LimeWire, maybe you remember Kassav, for example. These things have been really, really big back in, well, let's say around the late 90s, early 2000s. And it's not about file sharing per se, but you have to be aware that much of the technology and much of the ideas and much of the experience people gained with these peer-to-peer networks actually dates back to this file sharing. Another really interesting thing is, although there is no reason to think whatsoever that Bitcoin should be illegal, as far as I'm concerned, even if you happen to think that's the case, for whatever reasons, and we will discuss that later in our course, these examples show you how difficult it will actually be to stop a peer-to-peer network, how difficult it is to stop something that is distributed among various computers that where each node, each participant can just shut down and then another one pops up. Because, I mean, in these two examples here with Napster and LimeWire, much of the stuff that has been traded on there, much of the stuff that has been exchanged in terms of files was illegal. There is no doubt whatsoever. I mean, they, as I said, they didn't respect the law and the copyright protection and everything. So many regulators wanted actually to shut it down, but it was just really hard to do so due to the distributed nature. So the key difference you have to be aware of when we talk about decentralized networks, when we talk about peer-to-peer networks in contrast to heavily centralized ones, is that there is no centralized node. I mean, here in a centralized network, you have one node or a few nodes where everything goes through. And if this node is shutting down, well, when it's not working anymore, when these resources go offline, then the entire network will come to a halt. And as I mentioned, it's quite easy also for regulators to just step in, talk to this guy, shut it down, and then the entire network will be stopped. Now here, with all of these connections that can change dynamically, that aren't static in any way, with this really, really complicated topology, network topology, it's quite hard to do anything against it. There aren't any accidents that could cause this network to stop, except if all of these nodes go down at once. And one of these nodes just goes down, then the network will find new ways. And that's a big difference. Also, since no one is responsible in this network, since there is no boss, you cannot shut it down deliberately. And that makes these peer-to-peer networks really robust and a great architecture for some applications. Now, how does it work? Imagine you have a peer-to-peer network and you want to join. And what do you do? First of all, you have to install a client. You need some software that can connect to this network that corresponds to the protocol, and we will talk about that a little later in this slide deck, that allows you to connect to one or more peers in this network. And you have an initial problem. I mean, as decentralized that it is, initially, you need some address. You need some way of telling your client to whom to connect. And most of these clients, most of these peer-to-peer networks, they have some initial list. It can be something like a DNS equivalent, where you have some IP address of a server that gives you further IP addresses of additional clients, of additional people that are that have to have been seen online, that have been seen as part of this network in the past. Or alternatively, you can also just provide manually an IP address and connect to any of the peers you happen to know the IP address for. But in any case, initially, when you want to connect to the network, you need some IP address. You need to know somebody who's also part of the network in order to make this connection. Now, once you have this connection, this is a so-called handshake where you exchange certain messages to get a two-way connection. And in Bitcoin, as you will see in the next video, this is called version and version acknowledged, to establish the connection between the two. And as I said, that's called handshake. And then once you have that, you can share resources. Most networks, it's actually the other way around. In most networks, it's accessing, meaning that you're requesting for specific resources. You're requesting, does anyone have this particular data set, usually identified by a hash value, and then you get it in response. So that's the basic idea. But you connect, you have this handshake. Once you're connected, you can exchange data in a certain way and that corresponds to a certain protocol, meaning a way the information is structured and exchanged. And that's exactly what we have on this slide. There are some protocol specifications, and the entire communication between these nodes happens in this protocol specification. We can think of protocol specification as its own language, basically. So obviously, when machines, or in this case, clients, are communicating with each other, then they need, they require some structured form for the information. If you just have some unstructured information flow, also for the communication itself, the client couldn't read it. There is no way they could understand each other. So basically what this protocol is, what this peer-to-peer protocol means, is it's a set of rules of how to connect to each other and how to exchange the information. And that's it. Meaning that you could also, of course, program your own client. You could develop your own software packages in accordance with these rules, in accordance with this protocol, that would connect to this peer-to-peer network. And that's actually great. That's one great advantage of these peer-to-peer networks. That's not proprietary. It's just a set of rules, just a standard, and you can connect with any compatible client. Now, that's exactly what I said again, and it also allows the specialization of nodes. And you have various implementations. There could be an additional features, for example. There could be additional additional functionality on top of it. As long as it corresponds to the base rules, that's fine. It cannot contradict these rules, otherwise you're running at risk of not being able to connect, of course. And the idea that anyone can develop these clients, that anyone can come up with its own software packages, distributes the system in an entirely new dimension. It's not just the network itself, it's not just the topology, it's not just how everything is connected, but also when these people run different implementations, when they run various software packages, then it's also decentralized in this term. And that's really important. Also for Bitcoin, although there is a clear dominant client, there are various implementations, as you will see, and that's an important aspect of it, because you're not just relying on one software package, one team to maintain it, but rather on various projects that all happen to be in line with the same standards. So how does it work with peer discovery? Let's assume that's you right here, and you want to connect to this network. So again, you install this client, and then you connect to a known peer, as I mentioned earlier, on your list. So you have this initial IP address, and you connect to someone, okay? And then in step two, you ask this guy for a list of known nodes, or more precisely, their IP address. And although in this case, this node is connected to these example nodes, that doesn't have to be the case. You have to be aware that this node right here, he has a list of a really large list of nodes he came across, of nodes he knows to exist. And he shares this information with this person right here. That's usually done in a bootstrapping way. So that it would be possible that this node right here shares IP addresses with this initial node that he isn't even or he or she isn't even connected himself or herself to. So you could have really complicated and new ways how these nodes are connected, and it doesn't necessarily have to be peers this node is already connected to. Okay, but once our original node right here gets the information, this node can establish new connections. And again, this also could be this guy or this guy or this guy right here. It could be anyone in this network. That's just we structured the example network in this way so you can actually see something. Otherwise, it would just be a mess. But it doesn't have to be ordered in that way. There is really no logic of geographic proximity or anything like that. It's pseudo-random in an unstructured peer-to-peer network. And that way, it gets even more robust. Okay. So you connect to these peers, and then you have already three connections, and then you can again check their lists. You can ask them for new IP addresses, and then that way diversify your connections and establish new ones and really get a broad set of potential nodes for potential information exchange. And that's really important. In a peer-to-peer network, you don't just want to rely on one node, obviously. That would undermine much of its advantages. Instead, you want to be connected to many different nodes, and that's exactly what you're going to do here, okay? So a peer-to-peer network offers various key advantages. The first one that you will read everywhere, and that's it really is a key advantage, is that there is no central point of failure. And I did already mention that several times. So there is no single node that is critical for a functioning network. Any one of these nodes can shut down. Any one of these nodes isn't critical in terms of the system functioning. And there are no bandwidth bottlenecks. So even when there is a lot going on and there is much traffic in the system, it doesn't have to go all through one node. Okay, it's distributed, and potentially it depends on what exactly you're using it for. Potentially there can be bilateral information exchange. With blockchain, you have to be careful here because much of the information has to be distributed among all of the peers, as we will see. But in theory, and also when you're going into let's say second layer solutions of blockchain, this might be the case that you can just have connections between two of these peers, just have information exchange between two of these peers, and nobody else needs actually to know about this. Okay, then there is no central point of attack. It goes in the same direction. It's also, failure and attack is pretty similar. Here would be an accident. Here would be deliberate. But it's important that no node in this network has special privileges or powers, so they cannot attack the network from inside. There is no node that could be corrupted or anything like that, since they all have exactly the same rights. Since there are no special privileges, this is not an issue. And it was very, very difficult to overload the network via denial of service attacks. Again, this goes into no bandwidth bottlenecks. It's pretty similar. When you have a network where all the traffic goes through one node or to a certain set of servers, then you can actually attack it by overloading it with too many requests, and that's simply not possible here in this peer-to-peer network because there is no central point where you could attack. The information would just go different paths, would just go in different directions. And last but not least, no centralized infrastructure requirements, so you don't have to rent out servers, you don't need computing capacity in the cloud. It's just this peer-to-peer network that's distributed with the computers. Usually everyone has at home, and in that way there is no centralized infrastructure that could go down or have any issues. This by with the exception, of course, of the internet. That would be a big issue. There are some interesting projects, by the way, with the Bitcoin network, and I assume also for all the peer-to-peer networks, where they are even trying to solve that. So for example, with satellite connections, that you can exchange information off the usual grid of the internet. But that, of course, would be a big issue if the internet goes down. So that would probably be the only exception to this no centralized infrastructure requirement, because, it would be really hard to make the argument that ISPs, internet service providers, aren't centralized. And so much of what we're talking about, even for peer-to-peer networks, actually relies on a functioning internet, of course. And difficulty regulate and stop. I mentioned that. I don't think I have to talk about that again. We touched on that on the previous slide. Good. There, as always, are also some trade-offs. In this case, in terms of security, now this sounds much worse than it actually is, because you can check it, of course. You can validate it, as we will see later on. But most of these peer-to-peer networks, they have really high restrictions they place on the nature of the data, on the exact type of the data that can be exchanged that is part of a protocol. But in theory, a node can share malicious or irrelevant resources. And that is something you have seen, for example, in these illegal file sharing networks, in these illegal file sharing networks that are based on peer-to-peer technology. You had so many computer viruses, you had so much malicious code that was passed around through these networks. And that's, of course, whenever you have something that is heavily decentralized where anyone can just join, then this runs at risk of being used also for illicit activities and for malicious code, for example. Also, I mean, the regulation, it can be a great property in some cases. It's always a good idea when there isn't a single party, and this could also be a state that has the power to just step in and shut down everything. But of course, there is also dark side to that property, to that characteristic, and that is really difficult to regulate illicit activity. There are many illegal things that happen on these decentralized file exchanges, for example, and this is true for many peer-to-peer networks, and potentially could also be true to some extent for Bitcoin. Although I personally, when I look at the papers and the research in this area, I personally think that the number is really inflated, the number of to what extent Bitcoin is used for illicit activity, at least these days. It used to be quite different. I mean, in the early days, there are some indications that Bitcoin was used for various illicit activities, and it actually could have made up a substantial part of the transactions. And it, of course, it's when you have a network like that, and that's especially true for applications where everything has to be in sync, then it's limited by nodes with the weakest hardware. It's not necessarily true for peer-to-peer networks where you don't have to exchange everything, like file sharing. But when everything has to be in sync, as it will be the case with the Bitcoin blockchain, then you cannot have these huge hardware requirements, because you need the nodes that are part of this network to be able to keep up. You need to make sure that the weakest link in the network can actually verify everything, that the weakest link in the network can exchange everything if they have to be in sync. And that limits, of course, the computational capacity and therefore the speed of the network to the weakest hardware in the system. And if you want to have it distributed, then you have to make sure that these requirements aren't too high. I mean, obviously, you could say we need these supercomputers, and you can only join the network if you have one of those. And this could potentially make everything much faster, but it would very likely make the network much less decentralized, because you just raise this threshold value. You just raise the requirements, the minimum requirements for anyone to join, and that's usually not what you want to do if you want to make sure that your network is as distributed as possible. All right, so that's it already for the general overview on peer-to-peer networks. Next time, we will look into the Bitcoin network and how it employs peer-to-peer technology. So stay curious. See you soon.